new place faces welcome. Did you see ST is here?
Yes, I
okay.
Did.
And his wife, yes. You're important too. Yes. We're very happy. Yes, I spoke to Sister Melissa. I'm very happy to see her too. I'll be glad when this hour's over. But in the meantime, if you would just keep me in prayer, that would help a lot. Let's open our Bibles, please, to Isaiah 53. And we want to read verses 3 and 7, which says, "He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all." Alexander Bolotnikov stood before a famous Jewish work of art which portrayed Israel, the nation of Israel, as the suffering servant of Isaiah 53, which we have just read about. A well-known rabbi whom Bolotnikov recognized quietly joined him. After a few moments of silence, the rabbi asked softly, "Do you think the suffering servant is Israel?" Bolotnikov knew that this question had been hotly debated for centuries by the leaders of the Jewish leaders, and he didn't want to start a new debate and make a scene there. Bolotnikov, by the way, is an Adventist Jewish person. And I'm sorry to say, he responded in a neutral way. Here's this rabbi asking something from the depths of his heart, and he responded in a neutral way. Silence again settled as they continued to contemplate this work of art. Then the rabbi said slowly, "I wish I knew. I wish I knew." And he turned and walked away. You see, the Jewish people have no Savior. The beautiful verses in Isaiah 53 of the suffering Messiah who bears our griefs is not understood by them. In fact, they are forbidden, under a terrible curse of blasted bones, to even calculate the 70 weeks of Daniel 9, predicting this Messiah. So, when the shofar sounds, and every time I see that word, I think of you, Elvis. When the shofar sounds its mournful tones on Rosh Hashanah, it is a plaintive cry, if you've ever heard it, played by a true musician who's not fiddling around on it, but it's a cry. And it sounds its tones on the Jewish New Year, not only then, but it does then. That's Rosh Hashanah. When this happens, the Jewish heart is sad and empty, for the shofar signals judgment is near. Yom Kippur arrives in 10 days, and its plaintive cry resonates with the Jewish heart, anticipating judgment. 1 year has faded, and a new year is starting. But the Jewish people know no Savior who can cleanse them, and they know no intercessor who stands between them and Yahweh. Rabbi Nassen Sherman explains it this way. The shofar represents an inarticulate cry from the heart, a cry from someone who has no words because his sins may have become so indelibly ingrained and the barrier so firmly fixed around his heart that he cannot even mouth the words of repentance. But there always remains a spark, Rabbi Sherman says, in the Jewish heart, no matter how lifeless the spark may seem, even when there seems to be no hope. And the Jewish people have no hope, no Messiah, no assurance of forgiveness of sins. Jesus said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, your house is left unto you desolate." And then we have this quotation, "Divine pity marked the countenance." This is Desire of Ages. I'll give you the page in a minute. "Marked the countenance of the Son of God as he cast one lingering look upon the temple and then upon his hearers. In a voice choked by deep anguish of heart and bitter tears, he exclaimed, 'O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and yet ye would not.'" This is the separation struggle. In the lamentation of Christ, the very heart of God is pouring itself forth. It is the mysterious farewell of the long-suffering love of the deity. Pharisees and Sadducees were alike silent. Jesus summoned his disciples and prepared to leave the temple, not as one defeated and forced from the presence of his adversaries, but as one whose work was accomplished. He retired a victor from the contest. Israel, as a nation, had divorced herself from God. The natural branches of the olive tree were broken off, looking for the last time upon the interior of the temple. Jesus said with mournful pathos, "Behold, your house is left unto you desolate." Hitherto he had called the temple his Father's house, but now, as the Son of God should pass out from those walls, God's presence would be withdrawn forever from the temple built to his glory. Henceforth, its ceremonies would be meaningless, its services a mockery. That's page 620. And now, you understand the desolation that resonates within the sad cry of the shofar. It is devastating to see a people who are so religious, so conservative, so orthodox, who devoutly pray at the wall of the ancient temple, but who are destitute of salvation and who are dependent upon their works for acceptance with God. It is a terrible burden to be religiously inclined and yet have no Savior. And when Yom Kippur comes, the Jewish people feel an especial sadness, for they only have their works to commend them to God, and they never know if their good works outnumber their bad. And I base all this from the references I have from these rabbis. So, Rabbi Sherman says, when they cry out, like the plaintive shofar, at this time they cry out like the plaintive shofar, they do not know that God has said a mysterious farewell to their system of beliefs and services. They will find no redemption in it. But Rabbi Sherman seeks to offer comfort to his people. So he tells them that God shadows them, that God follows after them, seeking them. And it is true, God is seeking us, but they have no assurance that they are found and that they are accepted by God. Now let's turn to Ezra 8, starting in verse 23, we read Ezra 8:23. So we fasted and besought our God for this, and he was entreated of us. Then I separated 12 of the chief of the priest, Sherebiah, Hashabiah, and 10 of their brethren with them, and weighed unto them the silver and the gold and the vessels, even the offering of the house of our God, which the king and his counselors and his lords and all Israel were there present had offered. I even weighed unto their hand 650 talents of silver and silver vessels and 100 talents and of gold and 100 talents, also 20 basins of gold of 1,000 drams and 2 vessels of fine copper, precious as gold. And I said unto them, ye are holy unto the Lord, the vessels are holy also, and the silver and the gold are a freewill offering unto the Lord God of your fathers. Watch ye and keep them until ye weigh them before the chief of the priests and the Levites and chief of the fathers of Israel at Jerusalem, in the chambers of the house of the Lord. So took the priests and the Levites the weight of the silver and the gold and the vessels to bring them to Jerusalem unto the house of our God. Then we departed from the river Ahava on the 12th day of the first month to go unto Jerusalem, and the hand of our God was upon us, and he delivered us from the hand of the enemy and of such as lay in wait by the way, and we came to Jerusalem and abode there 3 days. Now on the 4th day was the silver and the gold and the vessels weighed in the house of our God by the hand of Meremoth the son of Uriah the priest, and with him was Eleazar the son of Phinehas, and with them was Josabad the son of Jeshua and Noadiah. I had to practice all of this. And Noadiah the son of Benui, Levites, by number and by weight of every one, and all the weight was written at that time. Also the children of those that had been carried away, which were come out of captivity, offered burnt offerings unto the God of Israel, 12 bullocks for all Israel, 90 and 6 rams, 70 and 7 lambs, 12 he-goats for a sin offering. All this was a burnt offering unto the Lord. And they delivered the king's commissions unto the king's lieutenants and to the governors on this side the river, and they furthered the people in the house of God. Ezra left Babylon with 12 priests and with gifts and with vessels of gold, of silver, of copper that had been taken from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar and placed in his temple in Babylon. We don't have a temple of old now. We personally don't have Jerusalem. We don't have vessels of silver, gold, and copper, but we do have something. We have the pure gold of truth. And we are the precious vessels of the Lord who have come from a Babylon, for we have all been tainted in one way or another by the errors of Babylon. We have all come, not carrying the vessels and the offerings of old, as did Ezra and the 12 priests, but we have come bearing great truths of God himself, the pillars of our faith that he gave his people over 150 years ago. Truths more precious than the gold, silver, and copper of Ezra's day. And we have been charged to keep those truths, just as Ezra measured his treasures before he left, and then after he arrived, we are to earnestly strive for the faith given us, and not lose one jot or tittle of it as we journey along. But we are having a hard time of it. The sanctuary, for example, is under attack. Corner of the world, I have no we'll just, I don't know what's next. We'll just keep going. In my corner of the world, there has not been the slightest interest in decades in the topic of Christ's ministry in the heavenly sanctuary, stated Dr. Milton Cook, a Seventh-day Adventist, pastor, a mission director, and a teacher of religion in the denomination. And then he listed seven problems with the Adventist doctrine of Christ's ministry in the heavenly sanctuary, two of which were that we do not understand the true function of blood in the earthly sanctuary, nor the Judean understanding of the Day of Atonement. And to gain this understanding, he referred his readers to what rabbis Nassim Sherman and Hirsch Goldwurm have written in the Art Scroll Tanakh series, and I have a few books of that that I got my information from. So, let us consider the function of blood in the earthly sanctuary and the Judean understanding of the Day of Atonement, for they have a bearing on our topic this morning, the scapegoat. Rabbi Nassim Sherman states in his introduction to the Day of Atonement, Rambam, I think I have that up there, writes that on Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, everyone's deeds are weighed in the heavenly scales of judgment. Those with a preponderance of good deeds are inscribed for life. Those with a preponderance of sin are inscribed for death. At first, one might think that Rambam means the names of the people who were judged are recorded in the book of life or in a book of death, or that the judgment determined is recorded beside each person's name, since he says inscribed. But this is not so. Sherman explains, there is a third category of people facing the judgment of Rosh Hashanah, those who are evenly balanced between virtues and sins. Of such people, Rambam writes, as for one who is evenly balanced, his fate is suspended until Yom Kippur. If he repents, he's sealed for life, and if not, he is sealed for death. Mm-hmm. On Rosh Hashanah, or on Yom Kippur, the Jewish people are sealed, and the account of the previous year is settled. If one's record has a preponderance of good works on Rosh Hashanah or on Yom Kippur, then that person is sealed for heaven for the new year. And if the person dies at any time during the new year, he or she remains a citizen of heaven forever, regardless of his behavior that new year prior to his death. It doesn't matter how you behave the 364 days of the new year, if you have been sealed for heaven at the previous new year or Yom Kippur. Regardless of your current trend of behavior, you will live forever in bliss. You have been sealed. If, however, during the past year your bad deeds have outweighed your good deeds and remain that way, on Yom Kippur, you are sealed for hell for the future 12 months until the next judgment on Yom Kippur, so that if you die any time during that year, you will suffer in hell for eternity with no hope of escape. Therefore, the Day of Atonement for the Jewish people is very serious. One is not left without hope, however, because immediately before Yom Kippur, what happens? The shofar sounds and alerts the people in 10 days Yom Kippur is coming. Those 10 days are sometimes called 10 days of awe, A-W-E, or 10 days of repentance. It's alerting the people that Yom Kippur is coming and you will be sealed and you need to be ready. So, the Hebrew people, with reverence and prayer, seek forgiveness of all sin, knowing that when the Day of Atonement or when Rosh Hashanah arrives, he or she will be sealed again, either for heaven or hell. Sealing for the Jewish people occurs one year at a time, and it is a sealing for the future year. But how can the Day of Atonement be important to the Jewish people when there is no longer a high priest officiating, no longer a temple, and there's no goat for the Lord and no goat for Azazel? The high priest is replaced by the theology that, since all Jews are united as one, because they're the offspring of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the achievement of one godly individual will exalt the rest of the nation. Doing what the high priest did for the nation anciently, interceding, in other words, the rabbis teach that at root Israel is one and its essence is good. And because of this essential oneness, an individual who genuinely repents is a blessing to the whole nation and elevates the whole nation closer to God. We see this in the life of Jonathan Stern, who lives today in Tacoma Park, Maryland, and worked at Gavi, an international organization founded by Bill and Melinda Gates in 2000 to benefit children in very poor countries. But in 2015, Mr. Stern experienced a seizure so severe it ripped the tendons from his left shoulder. A little more than a week later, he was diagnosed with terminal brain cancer, a glioblastoma to be exact, which is a terribly aggressive cancer. But Mr. Stern has his religious faith to support him. When he developed a deep vein thrombosis and had to keep his legs elevated for supposedly a long period of time, he couldn't take blood thinners, he said, "I kept my legs elevated for 24 hours per day, but I also did something my late grandfather, Rabbi Baruch Rabinowitz Robbins, urged if I ever was in extreme need. I'm a ninth generation descendant of Rabbi Israel Baal Shem Tov, the 18th century founder of the Hasidic movement of Judaism, and I am descended from other dynastic lines as well. Given this lineage, my grandfather told me I could draw on the collected good deeds of our ancestors in asking for intercession. A religious person, I did this by praying nightly." Rabbi Sherman, Mr. Stern, his grandfather, all believe that Jewish people who genuinely repent do for the nation what the high priest did in ancient times, intercede. Their deeds intercede, and that their good deeds continue to turn the mind of God to the needs of his people today. Oh, that's what they believe. But what replaces goats and sacrifices? They teach that the individual sinner does. The truest offering is when the owner brings himself as the offering. The owner negates himself to God, making himself and his desires subservient to the teachings and guidelines of the Torah. And I'll stop there. In other words, the animal represents the person who offered it, not a savior to come, and represents the surrender of his life to God. Just as the animal surrendered his life on the altar, pardon me. No animal sacrifice, therefore, is really needed today, because the person can mentally surrender himself to God without such a sacrifice. The rabbis teach that the ancient sacrificial offering simply represented the surrender of man to God, and thus was not a type of the lamb brought to the slaughter spoken of in Isaiah 53:7. But this does not explain, still, why God would require a blood offering. In the first place, surely total surrender could have been taught in a way that did not involve the death of animals. And for this, they have no explanation. As Ritva writes, the reason for the offerings is so profound that in its entirety it's beyond human comprehension, and the best efforts of our greatest thinkers can yield only a drop in the ocean of God's intent. Here's a passionate person speaking very eloquently, expansively about this incomprehension of blood offerings. The Jewish person does not understand the substitutionary death of the suffering servant of Isaiah 53, the lamb brought to the slaughter. So he is left with making himself better. In fact, he is taught that he, quote, must make himself better, that it's his mission on earth, end quote, and he never knows if he is accepted by God. Let us now consider a current Seventh-day Adventist theologian's view of the typical Day of Atonement. We've gotten just a background of the Jewish view. Now let's consider Dr. Martin Probstl is the principal author of The Sanctuary, the Adult Sabbath School Bible Study Guide for fourth quarter 2013, and was professor of Hebrew Bible at the Seventh-day Adventist Schloss-Bogenhofen Seminary in Austria at the time of the writing. In addition to writing the study guide and its companion book, he recorded video introductions for each lesson of the guide. In the video introduction for the lesson on the Day of Atonement, this is what he said. So there are four aspects on the Day of Atonement. One, the forgiven sinner who received forgiveness during the year and who is, does this sound familiar? This is Jewish theology so far, but it doesn't mean it's bad just because it's Jewish theology. But here, he says, the forgiven sinner who received forgiveness during the year and who is loyal on the Day of Atonement, he will be justified. In fact, his justification will be fixed and secured for eternity. Two, the forgiven sinner who has received forgiveness during the year but who is not loyal on the Day of Atonement, he will be cut off from the people. We don't have a problem with that. Three, the originator of sin will receive the sin and he will be punished forever. And four, God himself will be justified in all of his dealings he does during the second phase of that atonement. The rituals at the Day of Atonement foreshadow what God will do at the end of time, and this we will study in week number 9 and 10. That ends that part of his discussion. Now, Probstl is referring to the typical Day of Atonement when he makes these statements, and not to the anti-typical day. This is clear by the context of the video and by the use of the phrases during the year and the rituals at the Day of Atonement. But how can it be that an Adventist theologian would think that on the typical Day of Atonement, a person's justification was fixed and secured for eternity? Such a doctrine denies the freedom that one has to walk away from God at any time in the future, in which case all the sins previously confessed by that person and justified for him or her will return to the person's own shoulders to bear in the judgment. And we read that in one place is Ezekiel 18:24, and I won't take the time to read that. Ellen White also makes this statement in Manuscript Releases, Volume 2, 373. Pardon was written against the names of those who made thorough work, but if they again fall into a like snare and pursue an evil course, all their past evil is remembered against them. But worse than teaching this, worse than teaching that on the typical Day of Atonement, a person's justification is fixed and secured for eternity, he teaches that the originator of sin will receive the sin on the Day of Atonement, and he will be punished forever. Satan is not, and never has been, our sin bearer. Jesus is. Satan does not save us and has shed no blood for us. 1 Peter 2:24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. 6:20 says, there is a great work to be done, and every effort possible must be made to reveal Christ as the sin-pardoning Savior, Christ as the sin-bearer, Christ as the bright and morning star. Satan does receive something on the great final day of all atonement, symbolized in the typical service, but it is not the sins of the righteous or the unrighteous. Jesus bore them for us, paying the penalty so that we might inherit eternal life. And I'll explain that a little deeper for you in a little bit. But another issue to consider in the current Adventist Day of Atonement theology is that Aaron was told to take a young bullock on the Day of Atonement for a sin offering, Leviticus 16:3, to make an atonement for himself and for his house, verse 6. He was also told to offer the Lord's goat for a sin offering, verse 9, for the people, verse 15. But Probstl, as well as Dr. Richard Davidson, who wrote the teacher's components for the lesson, do not agree that the offering of the Lord's goat was actually a sin offering. And Probstl says in page 66 of his quarterly, teacher's quarterly, because there was neither confession of sin nor laying on of hands involved with the goat for the Lord, its blood was not a carrier of sin. Thus it did not defile, rather it cleansed. And then Davidson says a little later, no hands were laid on the head of the Lord's goat, and hence no sin was transferred to it. Its blood was sin-free. As sin-free blood, its function when applied to the sanctuary was not to defile, but to cleanse it. But the Bible says, Hebrews 9, verse 7. But into the second went the high priest alone, once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. Let us remember that no hands were laid on Aaron's bullock either, and no confession was made over it, but it was a sin offering. It was not a sin-free offering to cleanse, as they say the Lord's goat was to do, but both Aaron's bullock and the Lord's goat for the people are the same kind of offering. They're both called a sin offering, and they are both applied in the same way for the and are called the same thing. Either they both were not sin offerings, though the Bible says they were, and were offerings only to cleanse the sanctuary, or they both were actual sin offerings, which resulted in cleansing, yes. A question to be asked is, was any offering in the sacrificial service ever called a cleansing offering? Of course, no. All offerings in which blood was transferred to the sanctuary, either by sprinkling or by the priest ingesting part of the offering, were sin offerings. Blood from the burnt offering, for example, was never taken into the sanctuary. It was not a sin offering. All sin offerings resulted, hopefully, in forgiveness and cleansing, but no offerings were ever instituted for the purpose of only cleansing. Why Davidson and Probstl seek to redefine the sin offering of the Lord's goat, we cannot say, except that doing so is one of the main ways to biblically tie the Lord's goat, the type, with Christ's death on the cross, the antitype, a tying together with which we agree, for the Lord's goat is representative of Jesus. But the fact that hands were not laid on the goat And the fact that no confession was made over it does not qualify it as a sin-free offering, because Aaron's bullock was treated in the same way. In conclusion, the excerpts from Rabbi Sherman and from Rabbi Gold illustrate in a brief way the historical Judean understanding of the typical Day of Atonement, that it was a day of sealing based on good or evil works. Many Adventists believe that our historical understanding that the typical Day of Atonement is a type illustrating the work of Jesus in the heavenly sanctuary from October 22, 1844 onward is wrong. This may be because the Judean understanding of the Day of Atonement places no stress on sanctification, only on the review of the record of one's deeds with the appropriate sealing, and therefore we also need not place any emphasis on it today. Our justification is vital. It is salvational. We are indebted beyond measure for this great gift of God, and it is for eternity unless we walk away from God. We will thank and praise Him for our justification throughout the ages, but if we do not choose to allow God to sanctify us, if we are not willing to deny self through the power of God to the point that we would rather be hungry, thirsty, and in need than to sin, then we make a mockery of God's justification and mockery of justification and of the God who provides it. Now let us consider the true function. Hook wants us to consider the true function of blood in the sanctuary. The issue is encapsulated in the following quotation from Great Controversy. Important truths concerning the atonement are taught by the typical service. A substitute was accepted in the sinner's stead, but the sin was not canceled by the blood of the victim. A means was thus provided by which it was transferred to the sanctuary. By the offering of blood, the sinner acknowledged the authority of the law, confessed his guilt and transgression, and expressed his desire for pardon through faith in a Redeemer to come. But he was not yet entirely released from the condemnation of the law. On the Day of Atonement, the high priest, having taken an offering from the congregation, went into the most holy place with the blood of this offering and sprinkled it upon the mercy seat directly over the law to make satisfaction for its claims. Then, in his character of mediator, he took the sins upon himself and bore them from the sanctuary. Placing his hands upon the head of the scapegoat, he confessed over him all the sins, thus in figure transferring them from himself to the goat. The goat then bore them away, and they were regarded as forever separated from the people. Now, I know this seems a little contradictory to what I've just said, but explanation is coming up. Let's just stop for a minute and consider the importance of the offering of the Lord's goat. It is a sin offering, but Propsel and Davidson both deny this. If we are not clear on this, we will be in a grave situation. Broadly, two things happen when we sin. Our immediate repentance and forgiveness, represented by the daily sin offerings. And then when in the final atonement we are sealed, and at the bar of justice when our case comes up before the Father for judgment, during this process the blood is applied again. For Christ pleads for us as our high priest, and we read this in LS 119. Jesus was clothed with priestly garments. He gazed in pity on the remnant, then raised his hands and with a voice of deep pity cried, "My blood, Father, my blood, my blood, my blood." I asked my accompanying angel the meaning of what I heard, and he said, The merciful eye of Jesus gazed on the remnant that were not sealed. And he raised his hands to the Father and pleaded with him that he had spilled his blood for them. Then another angel was commissioned to fly swiftly to the four angels and bid them hold until the servants of God were sealed with the seal of the living God in their foreheads. And so daily, the daily sin offering, the blood was applied for forgiveness. Then in the day of the antitypical day of atonement, the blood is applied again as Jesus pleads for us before the Father. And this pleading is represented by the offering of the Lord's goat on the day of atonement and by its blood being sprinkled upon the mercy seat. It's a beautiful illustration. The Bible says the goat is the Lord's goat, verse 9, but that it was offered for the people, verse 15. The people are forgiven in the daily, typified by the daily sin offering, and then the remnant are sealed, represented by the typical day of atonement, both through the merits of the blood of the Lamb. The Jewish people have no concept of this true meaning of blood in the sanctuary service, but we do. That the sanctuary was symbolically defiled with sin by the sprinkling of blood and thus was in need of cleansing is what is another point that is often controverted when we consider the true function of blood in the sanctuary services. For many who disagree with the Adventist doctrine of the sanctuary believe that sin was symbolically washed away, cleansed by the blood of the sacrificial animal which represented Christ, and that this, of course, occurred in the courtyard. Since the sin was washed away in the courtyard, it was gone and could not be symbolically brought into the sanctuary. The sprinkling of the blood within the sanctuary, therefore, did not symbolize anything that defiled. But if it had nothing to do with the symbolic transference of sin, with what did it have to do? Many of those in disagreement with the Adventist doctrine of the sanctuary say that the sacrificial blood always cleansed or washed away sin. It justified and it cleansed at the same time. And this is what the sacrificial ceremony was all about. In this line of thinking, the symbolic blood of Jesus was brought into the sanctuary as evidence or proof that the sinner had been justified and that the sin had been washed away, all of which happened in the courtyard. The process was completed in the courtyard, and nothing further was needed for the sinner. The belief that the sacrificial blood in the daily services brought about cleansing leads to the belief that the atonement was completed at the cross, for no further cleansing is needed. And this is where the problem lies with Judaism. Although Judeans do not accept the death of Christ as an atonement, they do take seriously Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, for they believe they are sealed year by year on the annual day of atonement. And since they are sealed, no further investigation and cleansing are needed. Here also is where the problem lies with Seventh-day Adventists who do not accept 1844 as a theologically sound date and who do not accept the cleansing of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment as biblically based doctrines. There is no need of them since all was accomplished at the cross. And here also lies the problem with Propsel, who teaches, as we saw earlier, that justification was fixed and sealed for eternity for the individual on the typical day of atonement. Such Adventists are left with the most holy place theology of questions on doctrine, which states that what Jesus is doing for us now in the heavenly sanctuary is applying the benefits of the atonement accomplished at the cross, i.e., a ministry of justification and not of cleansing from sin and perfecting us as the gold of Ophir. Now I'm ready to move into the scapegoat, but I just want you to understand that the blood that was sacrificed was represented by the daily service, yet the blood of Christ, the Lamb of God. Forgiveness was made possible at that time. But the blood is also vital and necessary and needed in this great day of atonement, because He is pleading our case before the Father, or will be, and He cannot plead it without this beautiful gift that He is claiming, His blood. So it's important for forgiveness and justification, yes, but it's also important in this cleansing, not only of our record that goes into the depths of the sea and is never more remembered, that is made possible because of the blood of Jesus Christ, who gave His life so that we could have eternal life. So our records are cleansed, yes, but our characters are cleansed too. And all of this is encompassed in this beautiful gift of Jesus. Now, Leviticus 16 outlines the services on the Day of Atonement, and I have several steps that I'm just not going to go through for time's sake, but I have it all delineated. You can do the same thing I did. You just go down, 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 right, 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 and you got it. Okay, but let's consider the Hebrew word translated scapegoat, Azazel. Azazel is only used in Leviticus 16. The concept of the scapegoat is found nowhere else in the Bible. Azazel is composed of two smaller Hebrew words, az, A-Z-E, which means goat, usually a she-goat, and azal, A-Z-A-L, which means, in simple terms, gone, or departed, or left. But basically, Azazel is the gone goat, the goat taken into the wilderness. Now, the scapegoat has nothing to do with man's atonement and is not a representative of Christ. We know this because the sanctuary and the altar were cleansed, Leviticus 16, 18, and 20, before the scapegoat was brought to the high priest. And we know this also because atonement had already been made for the holy sanctuary, for the tabernacle of the congregation, for the altar, for the priests, and for the congregation. The scapegoat had nothing to do with providing atonement for man or with providing for his cleansing. Instead of doing the work of Christ and instead of representing Him, the scapegoat represents Satan. M.L. Andreasen from the Sanctuary Service, page 195, 2006 edition. And I mentioned yesterday that these were lectures he gave when he was teaching at the seminary. He says, "Some have mistakenly concluded that if the sins of Israel are finally placed on Satan, he must have some part in the atonement. This is a great error. Satan has no part whatever in the vicarious atonement. The saints are in no way indebted to him. His bearing of sin is in no way related to salvation. His work is evil and only evil. As the Lamb of God, Christ bore the sin of the world," John 3:16. "All the accumulated sins of men were placed upon Him. He is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe," 1 Timothy 4:10. "As the earthly high priest confessed the sins of the Israelites upon the scapegoat, so Jesus, the heavenly high priest, will remove the sins from the heavenly sanctuary and place them upon Satan. We read in Great Controversy 485. And we read in Great Controversy earlier where it said, where she says the sins were placed on the instigator of sin, so to speak. Here she says it a little differently, Great Controversy 485. As the priest, in removing the sins from the sanctuary, confessed them upon the head of the scapegoat, so Christ will place all these sins upon Satan, the originator and instigator of sin. The scapegoat bearing the sins of Israel was sent away unto a land not inhabited, Leviticus 6:22. So, she's saying, so Satan, bearing the guilt of all the sins which he has caused God's people to commit, will be for 1,000 years confined to the earth, which will then be desolate without inhabitant, and he will at last suffer the full penalty of sin in the fires that shall destroy all the wicked.
Amen.
Now, just as Ellen White used the word church in different ways, and understanding what she means can be confusing at times, so we find a couple of different ways she explains what is placed on the scapegoat. In most places, she says the sins of the righteous are placed on the scapegoat. And this is what Probstel is probably reflecting when he says that the originator of sin will receive the sin on the Day of Atonement. But we know Jesus is our sin bearer. So how can we put this together? The Bible says that the high priest confessed all the iniquities, the transgressions, and the sins of the children of Israel onto the head of Azazel, and that Azazel then bore these iniquities into a land not inhabited. And we know that only the sins of the righteous, those who had confessed their sins and had offered an offering, were transferred to the sanctuary, and that the sins of the wicked were not. So let's consider a few more issues, and I think the answer will be clear. Let's start with guilt. Ellen White says the scapegoat carries the guilt of the sins of the righteous. We read it above. So Satan, bearing the guilt of all the sins which he has caused God's people to commit. Another author explains it this way. Azazel is a symbol of the devil. When the whole work had been completed in type, the guilt was laid upon him. We use the word bear to describe Azazel's part. He was to bear the guilt into the wilderness. We say, too, Christ bore our sins. The words are used accurately, but the connotation we place on each is different. Unless he is careful, the superficial reader may think that we Adventists make Azazel our sin bearer. But that is silly. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Azazel never died in the ritual. The wages of sin is death. Azazel did not die. In the wilderness, he was to adumbrate, which means represent, Satan during the millennium. For 1,000 years, Satan will be in a land not inhabited. The universe will look down and say, is this the man that made the earth to tremble? And that's Leslie Harding, Shadows of His Sacrifice. Now, let's consider what the high priest symbolically placed on the scapegoat. The evil itself, the breach it caused, and the penalty it incurred. We read that in Leviticus 16:21. Where all three of those are mentioned, different words. The Hebrew word translated iniquities is avon, and means a perversity, a moral evil. The word translated transgressions is pesha. We heard about pesha yesterday. And it can mean a breach between two parties. And the Hebrew word for sin is kata. And it has many meanings, many nuances, but it can mean an offense and its penalty. For example, Judah agreed to be kata if he did not return Benjamin to his father after Benjamin's trip to Egypt. In other words, Judah would be as responsible for the offense of not returning him and would bear the penalty. Over the scapegoat were confessed the evil itself, Avon, the breach it caused, Pesha, and the penalty it incurred, Kata, and it was sent into a land uninhabited. Likewise, Satan will be bound in a land uninhabited for 1,000 years, after which he will be completely and fully destroyed. And we know this from several verses, which I won't take time to read, but I'll just give them to you. Revelation 20, 1 through 3, and the corresponding spirit of prophecy is Great Controversy 6:58. We also can connect this with Genesis 1, 2, and Jeremiah 4, 23 to 26. Connected with spirit of prophecy, Great Controversy 6:58 also. And also Isaiah 14, verses 18 to 20, and connected with Great Controversy 6:60. During the 1,000 years, between the first and the second resurrections, the saints will judge the world. We read in Great Controversy also, during the 1,000 years between the first and the second resurrection, the judgment of the wicked takes place. The Apostle Paul points to this judgment as an event that follows the second advent. Judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the heart, 1 Corinthians 4:5. Daniel declares that when the Ancient of Days came, judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, Daniel 7:22. At this time, the righteous reign as kings and priests unto God. John in the Revelation says, I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. They shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years, Revelation 20, 4 and 6. It is at this time that, as foretold by Paul, the saints shall judge the world, 1 Corinthians 6:2. In union with Christ, they judge the wicked, comparing their acts with the statute book, the Bible, and deciding every case according to the deeds done in the body. Then the portion which the wicked must suffer is meted out according to their works, and it is recorded against their names in the book of death. So, the saints judge the world, and the saints with Jesus will judge Satan and his angels. Great Controversy 6:61, Satan also and evil angels are judged by Christ and his people. Says Paul, Know ye not that we shall judge angels? 1 Corinthians 6:3. And Jude declares that the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. There are three phases to this judgment, and I'm sure you all understand them. The investigative phase, that takes place prior to the 1,000 years and determines who are saved and who are lost. The Father presides in this judgment, but he has committed all judgment to the Son, Daniel 7, 9 and 10, and John 5, 22. The judicial phase, this takes place during the millennium and determines the punishment of the lost, including that of Satan and his angels. Man does this in union with Christ And the executive phase takes place after the millennium and is the execution of the punishment determined by man with Christ. The Father bears this responsibility, Revelation 20, 6 and 9. Now, we know the sins of the righteous are cast into the proverbial depths of the sea and are remembered no more. They will cease to exist, so to speak, at the bar of justice when our cases are sealed for eternal life. Jesus bore their sins on the cross, but Satan will bear a partial punishment for all the sins of the righteous, for he led each person into committing each sin. He bears a responsibility in every fall from grace, moment by moment and day by day, though it has been forgiven of the sinner and cast into the depths of the sea when we are judged. Andreasen explains it this way. No Christian wishes to sin. He abhors it. But Satan tempts him. 1,000 times the man resists, and 1,000 times Satan comes back. At last, the man yields. But soon he repents. He asks forgiveness. The sin has been recorded in heaven. Now forgiveness is placed against it. The man is happy. He's forgiven. He has placed his sin upon the great sin bearer, who willingly takes it upon himself, pays the penalty, and suffers the punishment due the sinner. Then comes the final judgment. The sin is blotted out. The man's record is clear. But what about Satan's part in causing him to fall? Has that been atoned for? It has not. Satan must pay for it himself with his life. Satan will also be declared worthy of a partial punishment for every sin of every wicked person. The wicked will bear the responsibility for their own sins, for they did the sinning. But Satan snared them into sin. He enticed them, he deceived them, and he will be responsible, held responsible for his influence on them. He will be punished for his part in causing the performance of every wicked deed ever performed by them, and this includes all the sins of the fallen angels. Satan will also bear full punishment for his own sins. Upon no one else can a partial responsibility be placed. He is totally and completely responsible for his sins. No one led him into sin. No one enticed him. No one deceived him. And the amazing thing is, he will bow before the King of Kings and confess his sentence to be just. In other words, Satan will suffer for his own sins and for his influence in causing every other sin. It is important to understand that we also have an influence on others for which we are responsible, and we will be held accountable how we use this influence. We read in Youth Instructor, May 9, 1901, the punishment of the sinner will be measured by the extent to which he has influenced others in impenitence. Just as Satan is punished for his own sins and partially for the sins he has influenced others to perform, so the unrepentant sinner will suffer for his own sins and partially for the sins his influence persuaded others to commit. And here's an illustration from Andreasen. A sinner repents, seeks God earnestly, and receives forgiveness. In the day of judgment, the sin is blotted out, and even the record is gone. The sinner stands before God as if he had never sinned, clad in a robe pure and white, a new creature. His sin is washed away. What has happened? The death penalty which hung over the sinner has been removed. Christ died for the sinner, died in his place. He has taken upon himself the punishment which was due the sinner. He has suffered for the sinner's sake, and by his stripes the sinner is healed. Christ has taken his sin with him into the grave. There he paid the penalty. There he made an end of sin. What did become of the sinner's sin? It simply ceased to exist. Don't you want that to be true of each one of you? That your sins simply cease to exist. No more can they be brought to remembrance. Going back, when he, the sinner, by the grace of God gave up his sin, when he received forgiveness and cleansing, when he heeded the admonition, "Go and sin no more," sin came to an end. There was no more sin, no more uncleanness, no more transgression. It had all vanished. Christ has done a complete work. At the conclusion of the judgment, even the record is blotted out, and the sin can no more come to mind. What happened in this case happens in the case of every truly converted person. Christ takes entire charge. He takes the sin and its punishment. He forgives and cleanses. He creates a new heart and a new mind, and the sinner becomes a completely new creature. Another illustration. Why is it that guilt is placed upon Azazel or Satan? The reason may be simply illustrated like this. And Harding is speaking. He's in an auditorium speaking to a group of people. And if you're older like I am, you've been in those auditoriums where the windows are high and you have to use a pole to open the windows. Okay, he illustrates it this way. The auditorium has grown very warm. I ask one of the ushers to open a window. He takes a pole to push it up. As he is passing, a foot darts out, a mischievous foot, and he is tripped. He plunges the end of the rod through the window, and it is broken. Who broke the window? Why, we all saw it was the usher. But what we didn't see was that darting foot. So, with the sinner, we see him sin, but we do not always see the foot that tripped him. The tempter must be exposed to the universe when all his work is completed. Yes, we have all sinned. We must die. But Christ died for us, for everyone. He does not only bear the sins of the righteous. Christ has borne every sin of every man that came into the world. The purpose of the ceremony with Azazel is to point out to the universe that Satan is the instigator of it all. But how does this ritual of Azazel illustrate to the universe that Satan is the instigator of all sin? It is illustrated when the high priest lays his hands on the head of the scapegoat and confesses all the iniquities of the Israelites, all their transgressions, in all their sins. This is the complete package of all sins, everything. But confession is not made to gain atonement for sin, because atonement has already been made for them by the blood of the bullock and by the blood of the Lord's goat. When the high priest placed on the head of the scapegoat, what he placed was the guilt, the burden of guilt for all the iniquities, all the transgressions, and all the sins. Ellen White says in Patriarchs and Prophets 3:5-5, on the day of atonement, the high priest, having taken an offering for the congregation, went into the most holy place with the blood, sprinkled it upon the mercy seat above the tables of the law. Thus the claims of the law, which demanded the life of the sinner, were satisfied. Then in his character of mediator, the priest took the sins upon himself, and leaving the the sanctuary, he bore with him the burden of Israel's guilt. At the door of the tabernacle, he laid his hands upon the head of the scapegoat and confessed over him all the iniquities, all the transgressions, all the sins, putting them upon the head of the goat. It's the guilt, because Jesus already bore the sins, or eventually. Now do you understand what Jesus bore and what Azazel bore? Jesus bore the sins of the world to the cross and satisfied the demands of the law for its transgressions. But only the righteous accept this salvation, and only their sins are eventually cast into the depths of the sea, never more to be remembered. Wicked men and women are punished for their transgressions of the law, as well as for the influence they exerted others to causing others to transgress. The evil angels are punished for their transgressions of the law and for their influence in causing others to sin. And Satan himself is responsible for his own sins as well as for his influence in causing every sin ever committed by every being, angelic and human. None of us can begin to comprehend Satan's record, but one day he will face it. And that is why he will be after God's people in the last days with a vengeance never before seen, except toward Jesus. And it is his desperate plan to rid the world of every godly person so that there will be no righteous one left alive on the face of the earth. Then Jesus cannot come. There's no 144,000. And the world will be filled with a people who prove Satan's claim that no one can keep the law. That's why he's after you. We know that will not happen, but he thinks we're deluded enough to not understand his power to deceive and his power to coerce. His power is great, but our Savior is greater. And the faithful who stand in defense of the law of God are actually wounding the head of Satan. We read manuscript 55, 1886. The Lord said concerning Satan, that old serpent, that he should bruise the heel of Christ, but Christ would bruise his head. Thank God he cannot touch the head. With the mind, I myself serve the law of God, Romans 7:25, said the prophet. The mind and heart are enlisted in the service of Christ, while Satan has enlisted men and fallen angels to join his company to league against good. They can only bruise the heel while in the very act. When Satan seems to have triumphed in putting them to torture and to death, the faithful who stand in defense of the law of Jehovah are wounding the head of the great rebel. You have a great work to do. You're wounding the head of Satan himself. A terrible, very terrible battle is soon to break before us, and we must be ready. Patriarchs, Prophets 202, it was by self-surrender and confiding faith that Jacob gained what he had failed to gain by conflict in his own strength. God thus taught his servant that divine power and grace alone could give him the blessing he craved. Thus it will be with those who live in the last days. As dangers surround them and despair seizes upon the soul, they must depend solely upon the merits of the atonement. We can do nothing of ourselves. In all our helpless unworthiness, we must trust in the merits of the crucified and risen Savior. None, here's a great promise, none will ever perish while they do this. The long black catalog of our delinquencies is before the eye of the infinite. The register is complete. None of our offenses are forgotten, but he who listened to the cries of his servants of old will hear the prayer of faith and pardon our transgressions. He has promised, and he will fulfill his word. Remember that promise. As long as you trust in the merits of the death and resurrection of Jesus, the removal of both the guilt for the sin of the righteous from the heavenly sanctuary and of their record of sin is the most profound event in the history of the universe. And we are living at such a time. We see in these services of cleansing the complete method by which God proposes to remove guilt. And it is the profoundest transaction, the most thrilling event in the history of the universe. The Bible is clear that the scapegoat does make an atonement. We read about it in Leviticus 16:10. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. So the scapegoat makes an atonement, but how can this be? For the blood of the scapegoat is not shed, and without the shedding of blood is no remission of sin, Hebrews 9:22. It is so because the atonement made by the scapegoat is of a different nature than that made for the remission of sins, even though the same word, Hebrew word for atonement, kafar, is used. We know that the bullock and the Lord's goat were offered as sin offerings to effect kafar, and Leviticus 16:20 tells us an end was made of reconciling, that's kafar again, before the scapegoat was called to the high priest. The difference in the atonements is that the one made by the scapegoat was made with the Lord, Yahweh, whereas the atonement procured by the sin offerings was for the people. We read about that in Leviticus 16:34, just over here. And this shall be an everlasting statute for you to make an atonement for the children of Israel for all their sins once a year. And he did as the Lord commanded Moses. One atonement is made with the Lord. Oh, how does it go? Let me read again. It says with him. One atonement is made with the Lord. The other atonement is made for the people. Now, this is how the difference is portrayed by Ellen White. Great Controversy 670. Satan sees that his voluntary rebellion has unfitted him for heaven. He has trained his powers to war against God. The purity, peace, and harmony of heaven would be to him supreme torture. His accusations against the mercy and justice of God are now silenced. The reproach which he has endeavored to cast upon Jehovah rests wholly upon himself. And now Satan bows down and confesses the justice of his sentence. Romans 4:11 says, every knee shall bow. Okay, and one more, the youth instructors, July 5, 1901. At his second coming, the scene is changed. He is acknowledged by all as the King of Glory. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Lord of heaven and earth, to the glory of God the Father. The angels bow in adoration before him. His enemies see the mistake they have made, and every tongue confesses his divinity. We read earlier, Satan bows, all the wicked bow. Now the atonement is complete. The whole universe now is at peace because Satan no longer is making war. He capitulates and he says, you are righteous. My sentence is righteous, a righteous sentence. He no longer fights against the God of heaven. And now peace is restored. The atonement is complete. And that's why this scapegoat is such a profound illustration to us about what is going to happen when Satan confesses. Every living creature throughout the universe is now in agreement with God. Peace and harmony are restored, and the atonement is now complete. May God be praised.